Well, good morning. If this were an ordinary Sunday, I would be greeting and connecting all of Faithbridge by saying something like this. If you're in Center Court East or Center Court West, welcome. We're glad to have you with us today. If you're at the Woodlands campus, we're specifically glad to have you. Glad to see you today. And if you're joining us online, we're glad to have you with us as well. If we don't already know each other, my name is Wayne Risher, and I'm the campus pastor for Faithbridge in the Woodlands. Well, this is not an ordinary Sunday, though, so I'm not saying any of those things. I'm just greeting you specifically here at the Woodlands campus today. In fact, this is the first time we've ever done this before. We're going to pull off the side of the road and just take a few minutes to celebrate our 12-month anniversary as a campus. It's amazing what's gone by in a year. A whole year has gone by, 12 months, but immediately following the service today, we're just going to delay our teardown about 10 minutes. So if you're a parent and you have kids in kids ministry, please go grab your children quickly and bring them back to the lobby. We're going to do a family-friendly celebration. I want to make sure all of our kids ministry folks can participate as well. We have hundreds of little mini cupcakes set up all over the lobby. I want to come back as a group and celebrate our one-year anniversary together. So after service is over, go grab your kids and let's do that together. Well, let me just say that if you're a guest with us today, I'm especially glad you're with us, because this is not only an unusual Sunday, but an opportunity for you, whether you've been here first, or second, or third time, to kind of get a look under the hood of what's happening here at Faithbridge, and specifically Faithbridge at the Woodlands campus. So I'm glad you're here. Well, as I was pondering our one-year anniversary, I was thinking about all of you, many of your faces coming to my mind, and I was thinking that you're probably sitting there as you've come in over the past year, saying to yourself, well, this is a pretty incredible conversion of a school into a church facility each week, but you probably have three questions on your mind, three questions that we need to spend a little time on this morning. The first question is, you're probably asking, if you've come in during the past year, so how did we get into school in the first place? And what are we even doing here? Well, that would be a good question. The second question that most people are asking, well, if we've been here for a year, it begs to know, how's it going? So we'll take a look at that. And then third and finally, we want to look at where we're headed in 2016 and what the year ahead looks like. All good questions. So we'll take a minute to pull off the side of the road and just have a kitchen table talk today, just you and I, where we can kind of connect, have some clarity around these three questions. And then I want to take a look at a potential problem we have on the horizon for 2016 that I'm hoping to head off at the pass as we talk about that. So before we jump into our kitchen table talk this morning, let's ask God just to go ahead of us and bless our time together. Father and God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for this time. Lord, there's so many things that we want to know and answer, and we're curious. And today, won't you just give us the answers to those things? Give us hope. Help us see your hand in our story, and Lord, be with us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, in the Old Testament, God was very concerned that people were connecting with God, and they were remembering the story of that intersection. The scripture is full page after page after page in the Old Testament of how God helped them remember their deliverances, their celebrations, incredible times of provision. God was helping his people remember his story as much as possible, using all sorts of things. Well, let me illustrate this way. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, Moses is teaching, and he's instructing the Israelites and preparing them for life when they get into the promised land. And he says in Deuteronomy 6, verse 5, love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your strength. These commands that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on your door frames of your houses and even on your gates. In other words, don't forget this important teaching. Right now, we're at an intersection. You've got to remember this time. I don't care what you do. Drastic measures. Write those instructions out. You may also recall a little time in the Israelites' history when Joshua was instructing them to set up a memorial. Sort of a time when they were about to cross the River Jordan, and there was one of those moments where some instruction was happening and the water was flowing in incredible ways. And so there were stones, of course, around, But the Lord didn't tell them to go and grab those stones. The Lord told them to go and grab some stones out of the center of the water. Stones that would have been worn smooth. Stones that people would have been able to look at and say, huh, those aren't the rough, jagged stones sitting out here. Those are obviously stones that would have come from the middle of the river. Yeah, that's exactly right. And what they did is they established a little memorial, and they stacked those round stones up. And when they did that, we see what the scripture tells us. Why would they do that? God said in Joshua 4, this is what Joshua said, 4:20. Joshua set up at Gilgal the 12 stones they had taken out of the River Jordan. He said to the Israelites, in the future, when your descendants ask their parents, what do those stones mean? You tell them, Israel crossed the Jordan River on dry ground. For the Lord your God dried up the Jordan before you until you had crossed over. The Lord your God did to the Jordan River what he had done to the Red Sea when he dried it up before us until we had crossed over. He did this. Why? He did this so that all of the peoples of the earth might know that the hand of the Lord is powerful, and so that you might always remember and fear your God. Well, Jesus did the same sort of thing. We know in his ultimate sacrifice, shedding his blood and breaking his body for us. We know in Luke chapter 22, verse 17, regarding his own sacrifice, he told us even in the New Testament, every time you get together and have communion, Luke 22, 17 said, do this in remembrance of me. So whenever we gather to celebrate communion, we would remember the story of what Christ did for us in his sacrifice. Well, we sort of do the same thing today, if you think about it. July 4th celebration. Not a one of us in this room were in the generation that fought for our freedom, but yet we celebrate it year after year. Why? So we can tell the story of what happened at those times and why we celebrate our freedom today. Some of you will put a ring on your finger that will represent the college you attended and how that story intersected in your life with your higher education. On the other hand, some of us will put a ring on our finger to celebrate and remind us of our wedding or our marriage story. We get together on our anniversary. Sometimes it's just a date night out, and you're just glad to go. Say, honey, we're sitting down. I just didn't even buy you a card this year. And to which he or she may reply back, well, I didn't get one for you either. That's okay. And you sit down and enjoy your date night out. But oh, no, it needs to be so much more than just a date night out. That's the time when you have to remember the story of what brought us together. How did our lives intersect? And what do we do in our relationship to really affirm this decision we made to wear these rings in the first place? Or a birthday. We celebrate those. Mom, Dad, tell me one more time what it was like that night when you and Dad drove to the hospital, had your bag packed, and you were driving that old car. We want to remember the story that goes along with it. And so likewise, as God's local church here at Faithbridge, at the Klein campus, at the Woodlands campus, we have a story that God wants us to remember. And he wants us to share it with others because God has something to show us and teach us in this moment, just like the Israelites. He's bringing us together for a purpose to build disciples, to build his kingdom. And I've been here for nearly 15 years. But I can tell you the story of Faithbridge way predates me, going all the way back. And so for many of you, dozens and dozens of you who have come in the past year, you don't know all of Faithbridge's story and how we're intersecting with God's story as a local church. So I thought I might just illustrate briefly for you so you can come along in the story with us. So what God was doing is as he was going to be the king, God builds for himself a nation. And this nation has been given a law. They've also been given a promised land. And of course, a nation is no good unless you have some people. So as God was building his nation and putting together for himself a great nation of people, the Israelites, his chosen ones, he looked at the story and he said, well, that's fine, but it's not enough. He said, just these people, I'd like to add to it. In fact, there are some people who are non-Jews, non-Israelites, I'd like to invite into my story. So God then says, well, I'll do this. I'll send my son, Jesus, to establish his church. He'll die on the cross for the sins that I could never pay for. And when Jesus comes into our story, he's fulfilling and calls us to a place of Matthew 28 with a great commission to go and make more disciples. And so that happens. And we see in Acts, as the church begins to be established, we see that Judas is gone, and now the team is coming together as 11. They've chosen a replacement, and the boys are together, the apostles, the disciples are together, and the group of 12 go out and begin to establish the church. And boy, establish it they do, because I'm telling you, the church begins to just explode. And the first century church has 39 cities and over 30 countries where the church is expanding to. And I mean, the church is going crazy. Well, as the church continues to expand, years later, we see something else happen. That is that God continues to use people, and he whispers to a young guy, and he says, "Hey, Ken, I think I'm calling you to go and be a church planter." So this young guy, a church planter, he says, well, full head of hair here, he said, yes, I'm going to respond to the call, God. I am definitely going to go. And he says, yes. And Faithbridge story begins. Well, as that happens, Ken sort of parachutes down from a church planting place with a little bag of money and says, I'm going to land in Spring, Texas, and there I'll establish a new church, and we'll call it Faithbridge. Well, as the Faithbridge story continued to grow and continue on, they met in Ken's apartment for some time. Just a number of people, and as people began to come more and more and more, they had to move out of there and go into a Kids Are Kids daycare center. Well, while they were there, meeting in the Kids Are Kids place, people continued to grow. People continued to come into community. The numbers of them grow. The depth of their spiritual life continued to grow. And before long, they had to move out of there into a much larger place. They moved into Kleb Intermediate School. And so they converted that into a church on Sunday mornings. And we were in Kleb for years and years and years. Well, as we were standing there in Kleb, for seven some years, hundreds and hundreds of people began to gather and grow. People who were single, people who were married, people who had troubled situations, people who were getting engaged and having families, and lives were mended, marriages were healed, people were saved. As it continued to grow, we realized we couldn't stay there forever. We had to move on. Well, an anonymous donor gave $100,000 to begin a land campaign, and Faithbridge found, after praying over many different places, parking lots of different businesses, Faithbridge bought the Benfer Farm in Spring, Texas, and there we built our first location and our permanent facility at 18,000 Steubner Airline. Well, that's great, and we continued to grow. In fact, not only did we continue to grow, but our time there as it went on ministered to more and more people, and God's people continued to come. Well, we were there, and one of our buildings was Center Court West. And in Center Court West, we held worship services. That didn't last very long, and before long, we were saying to ourselves, well, we need to add another place where we also greet in the morning to you in Center Court East, to you in Center Court West. We added Center Court East, another building to the east, so we'd have a separate worship venue, another place for us to continue to expand. And Faithbridge has always been about being a sending church. I can't even tell you how many times I've thought about the mission trips that have gone out, the road that we use for students, adult mission trips and bridging. I thought about the church planters because, you know, Faithbridge is involved with the Houston Church Planting Network. And we send out even church pastors. We raise them up and we train them and give them an opportunity to send them out. And Faithbridge has always been about being a sending church. And I was thinking about all the great things that are happening, the people who have come and been part of community and all those things, and Faithbridge being sent out. And I thought to myself, gosh, if our story just ended right there at 18,000 Steubner Airline, wouldn't that be so sad? We'd never have an opportunity to go and do something new or something else. So we began thinking, well, what else would God have for Faithbridge? And we started thinking about the fact that if Faithbridge could be stronger with two campuses, or three, or four, or five, or six, could we not even be a bigger sending church, and how would that be? Oh yeah, we like that idea. So if we really believed that that was true, what would we do? We'd go and we would launch something. So that's where we began all kinds of dreaming. What would this thing look like? We had no idea what it would look like, but we thought maybe we'd get together and it'd be a place where people could worship together and be bridges of faith every day, just like we are at the Klein campus. Thinking about all those things, we were thinking, well, maybe it would be a satellite campus. Maybe it'd be a campus that would sort of, I'll go back here to this one, orbit around the mothership, if you will. That didn't feel like Faithbridge. Maybe it would be a mother-daughter sort of relationship where we were sort of just helping one another. Or maybe it would be a sister church over here to the side. Maybe it would be a parachute plant, sort of like what Ken had at the very beginning. But none of those really felt like Faithbridge to us. So we landed on something called a multi-site. A multi-site. Let me give you the definition of a multi-site in case you're new and you don't know. A multi-site is one church meeting in multiple locations. One church meeting in multiple locations. That's Faithbridge. That felt exactly right to us. So a small group of us began to plan and pray and figure out exactly what we would do to bring new people in who could intersect with Faithbridge and God's story, just like they did with Tammy and I so many years ago as our story intersected. We began how God might move in our lives. We might reach a new territory, a new place, a new stream to fish in for the kingdom. And some of us began to get together over dinners, coffees, breakfasts, lunch. I remember at one point in time I was at a barbecue place in the Woodlands, and I took the whole napkin. It was like a butcher block tablecloth thing. We had written church stuff all over it about groups and serve teams and all. How would that be like? I tore that off and saved that. I have that in my little box at home I'm keeping. All kinds of great things there. And then we landed on it, a multi-site in the Woodlands. And there we met about 35 families, which ended up being about 70 people in number. We landed at the YMCA in Creekside on Sunday nights, worshiping together, praying together, talking about how our groups would build community, how our serve teams would get together and build community, and we would work to reach people for the kingdom. Because it was never about us. The whole time we were considering all these things, we never decided we wanted to set up and tear down for us. It was always for new people that God would send into our lives. We set out an empty chair, in fact. We even prayed over the empty chair. We stood there and prayed and prayed and prayed. God, who would you send to us? Would it be folks who are hurting marriages, children who don't know you yet? Lord, would it be families who are broken? Lord, would it be people who are coming with all manner of situations? And we set out that empty chair and we wrote all over the place, different groups, some by name, some groups, some specific folks, just praying over them that God would use us in such a way that would heal marriages, that would bring people to salvation, and we prayed that God would send even a generation of kids to us so that we could be together well. That church that met together for four Sunday evenings at the YMCA began the campus that started meeting together as Faithbridge in the Woodlands on Sunday morning in February last year. When our trailers arrived for the first time, oh man, it was so exciting. I can tell you, though, that we never intended to set any of these things up for us. It was always for the next person coming. It was for the empty chair that we had been praying over. Who would God send so we could minister to them? Well, now I'll tell you, you're pretty well up to speed on the story, and that connects you into where you're going, and I promise to bring you through three quick questions. Well, I'll answer that by saying, if you're part of the story now, and you know where you're at. So now the question is, well, what are we doing here anyway? Well, let me tell you that we're the best from Faithbridge of yesterday and today, but at a new location. Same church, same mission, making more and stronger disciples for Jesus Christ who make more and stronger disciples for Jesus Christ by being bridges of faith to people every day. We worship together, we grow together, and we serve together. And even in your bulletin, you can see on the back the little icon that we have a little rhythm we use at Faithbridge called Grow Plus Two. And that rhythm is helping us be in community together, growing in groups and community. We're building teams that serve one another and serve outside the walls of the church. And we also worship together on Sunday mornings and other times, always being a bridge of faith along the way to people in our community. Well, as we're doing all of that, you can say, okay, Wayne, I got it. I got the story. Now I'm part of it because I'm sitting here. However, I'm not sure I understand what the rhythm is here. Can you just maybe communicate that a little bit? Yes. So we decided to launch the Woodlands campus out really with five things. That was our plan. We didn't think we could do everything well, but we could certainly do five things well. The first thing we wanted to do, we wanted to launch with worship service, just like we have at the Klein campus in Center Court East and Center Court West. And it was really important for us to launch out with relevant kids ministry. Faithbridge believes in generational relevance. We wanted to make sure that was definitely something we launched with. We also wanted to launch with Faithbridge student ministry so we could reach junior high and high schoolers, train them up to be disciple makers in the kingdom as they go along their way. And also we wanted to launch with serve teams because it's not about us, but we're serving inside and outside the walls of Faithbridge. And we wanted to launch grow groups so that people could be part of the faith community. All of that under the guise and operation of prayer in our engine room, because we believe in fervent prayer at Faithbridge. So that was our umbrella that sort of held everything together. Well, so let me talk about these for just a minute. Specifically, let's talk about worship for a moment. So let's talk about worship and how things go. We're one church, and you may know that we're using the live teaching technology to connect us each week. We use that live teaching technology because we're one church connected on one mission, sharing one message each week. Now, we use a teaching team. So if you haven't noticed, there have been different folks rotating in. Pastor Dan, Pastor Ken, Ben is on our teaching team, and several others. Well, it's great because the teaching team allows us to have a new voice, a new perspective, a different area of expertise, keeping a fresh voice in front of us each week as God speaks to each one and helps us understand what's going on there. Now, as your campus pastor, I do rotate in on the teaching team from now and then, but that's not my primary role. My primary role is not to provide content each week, but to make sure that we have these five things operating. Make sure we're prepared and ready for the next person to come in and be in the empty chair and to minister and serve them. Well, since I don't have to provide content each week, let me tell you what an incredible blessing that is to give me margin. So, for example, while I want to get to know each of you and while we're together in fellowship, I don't want to just know you, I want to know your children as well. Since I'm not going to have to provide content every week throughout the year, our teams begin to manage the operational things of the five things that we launched with that we want to do with excellence. But it gives me an opportunity now to spin into kids ministry. I don't want your kids just to wonder, who is that guy sitting at my kitchen table? I want them to know me as the guy from Faithbridge, right? The campus pastor. I want to have an opportunity to go in and be silly with them in their classroom, to teach them a lesson, wear a crazy wig and sunglasses, and do some generationally relevant teaching with them so that when the time comes that they have questions and they want to be baptized, I can be part of their story. I also am looking forward to the day when they join the junior high and the high school student ministry, the road program, where they go out and we can call them right up front and I can pray over them and send them out on their mission trips. So those moments are only gifted to us because we use a teaching team at Faithbridge. And so that's an important thing. And then my most important role I'm looking forward to is just building relationships with you and being in community with you. Now, you also know we use a rotating team for our worship. So you'll see the same people at Klein as you see at the Woodlands campus. We rotate right through Center Court East, Center Court West, and up to the Woodlands. Make sure we all experience the same worship experience along the way. And we keep adding things as we go along, and we're able to. It's an exciting time for our campus. Well, I filled your bucket full of all kinds of answers on what we're actually doing. I hope you have that, and it's very clear. But now the question number two comes to mind, and that is, well, mirror, mirror on the wall, are we doing any good at all? And here I'm happy to tell you on several fronts, we're doing fantastic. In fact, our worship services are going great. I'm loving the teaching. The worship leaders that we have are just bringing incredible time for us to worship and come right before the Lord. So I'm so pleased about our worship services. And kids ministry, oh my gosh, completely fantastic. The same lessons all across Faithbridge, no matter what venue you're at. The kids are getting the same fun learning experience, intersecting with the truths of Scripture. And we have so many record moments where we can just say, well, God has definitely given us this opportunity to speak into the lives of young people. Student ministry, they're gathering themselves, and junior high and high school students having their own time on Sunday morning and also on Wednesday nights where they have their own community. So we're building into the next generation of leaders and disciples and disciple makers there. Grow groups, oh, I'm very excited to report to you that we have about a dozen grow groups heading right toward 20 at the end of this year already at the Woodlands campus. There's a place for everybody in every station of life, working together, speaking in and out of lives. It's great. Serve teams. Serve teams blows my mind. Thank you for all you're doing, for setting up, for tearing down, for hospitality, for greeting, for praying, all the different areas we're serving around here. Even a half a dozen more people joined in last week into our serve team situation to make sure we're experiencing community and setting up for the next person. So all the things we purpose to launch with, all five of these things, I can definitely say without question, I'm giving you a thumbs up on that. It's all going very, very well. Well, attendance is another way of looking at it, and that's trending up nicely. If you've been in the room for the last several weeks, you know it's feeling a little more crowded each week as we go along. And when I say, well, how is it going at the Woodlands campus? If I'm asked that question, frankly, I don't want to tell people, well, we're having over 200 adults and kids on campus now. Or if you take away Easter service last year, as that large event skews the numbers a little bit, we're actually over about 26% prior year. I don't want to tell all those things because I don't think it actually conveys the real story of what's happening. I want to tell people when they say what's happening at the Woodlands campus, I want to say, you won't believe it. We've even had security officers come and accept Christ. Marriages who were heading toward divorce when they first came here are now mended. In fact, they're actually helping others. About how many people were disengaged from God are now back in the faith community, and they're serving together alongside parents who are regularly reporting to me about their kids and what they're getting in terms of biblical truth. I can't even tell you, even one of our own children's workers, leaders, her child was baptized this year. Men coming to be better husbands and dads. About the fact that we launched without knowing anybody at the school, and now we have several families who are coming from the Colson Tough community, and their kids are sitting there in the library on Sunday morning, and they're looking around, and they're telling their friends during the week, you won't believe this place. This is my church on Sunday. We're in the library. You can't tell it's a library, but this is my church on Sunday, and inviting their friends into the story. I can't even count to you how many times we've had ministry experiences with the teachers at the school or our prayer team and how lives have been changed and impacted there, and God is moving. So all these lives being transformed, that's why we're here. I can spend all day telling you about those sorts of things because those are the stories that I get to hear. It's just not about the trajectory of the number of people here, but it's what's happening in our lives that I'm excited about. And so when I hear all of those stories every week, I thank God for them. But I'm telling you, when I ask the question or I hear the question being asked, so how's it going at the Woodlands campus, I want to say that is the story, the changed lives and transformation in people's homes. That's the story of our campus that I want us to remember. That's the story I want to stack the stones on and say those are the moments we can count as an intersection with life in God. Well, the third question, where are we headed in 2016? Well, I told you there was a little problem. When you have so many good things happening, sometimes there's a challenge. And so let me just head this challenge right off at the pass, and here it is. It's our assimilation rate. As a Woodlands campus, another word for that might be our engagement ratio. That is one number I do look at because it tells a story to me. It is a stacking of the stones I can look at, and I can interpret it as a story of how many of you are experiencing life-changing community here at the Woodlands campus. And so this is where our challenge lies. It's in our engagement rate. Well, most churches would be dying for experience like this, but I'm telling you, our engagement rates are way too high. In fact, they're super high. One could say they're too good. We never came here for us. It's not about us. It's always about the next people thinking about the empty chair and want to have room and capacity for the new folks to come in and be part of what God's doing in our story, always inviting others into the community of faith. So let me tell you, in grow groups, this will surprise you. We actually have 127% of our folks engaged in a grow group experience. 127%. It's fantastic, no doubt. And you say, well, how is that even possible? How can you have more than 100% of people engaged in something, right? I'll tell you how, because you take the number of attenders in a worship service, and then you look at the number of people who are engaged in groups. And when you have over 100%, that means you have more people attending multiple groups. I may be in a couples group, and I may be in a men's group. I count twice. My engagement ratio is twice. Well, it's even more unbelievable in serve teams. You won't believe this. We have 152% of our people engaged at the Woodlands campus in serving. This means that compared to the number of people who are here on a Sunday morning, we have more than 100% serving. It blows my mind. So thank you, thank you, thank you for hospitality and for prayer teams and setting up and tearing down all the things that you're doing faithfully each and every week to be prepared for the next people. But that's the problem. You say, well, what in the world could be wrong with that? Don't you want a church where people are engaged? Don't we want to have a community that's all connected around the common mission? Well, yes, 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 of course. But guess what? Those numbers only represent about 60% of you. So we're deep in engagement, but we need to move to a place in 2016 where our engagement level goes wide. Those represents about 40%, those numbers represent about 40% of you who have yet to jump into a grow group. About 40% of you who have yet to jump into a serve team. And I realize you're new and you're just figuring all this out, and that's why we're having this kitchen talk today. So you can understand where there's lots of on-ramps for you to experience the community that we've got at Faithbridge and connect with others. Well, those numbers are about as high as I hoped they would ever get, and I don't want them to get any higher. In fact, we need to start to drive those numbers down because I need more of you to get engaged so that our numbers can go wider and we have capacity for new people to come in, because if it's TikTok, the game is locked, just us four and no more. There's no room for people to come onto a new team. That's not the Faithbridge way. That's definitely not the way we want to run things. In fact, this is sort of where we've been for 2015. We've sort of gone like this, and we've basically gone from Sunday to Sunday. And we've pulled those trailers in, we've set them up, we've unloaded all those cases, and we've been asking ourselves, well, we put out these chairs and all these things, can we just make it? Can we just really make it from a Sunday to a Sunday as we set up things each week? It takes a lot of work. So from this Sunday to this Sunday, can we make it? Do we have enough servers to put up the truss? Do we have enough servers to put out another 50 chairs this week? Do we have enough people to minister to all the kids who are coming? Do we have enough people can get here and just be leaders in student ministry? Do we have enough people who can serve donuts? Do we have enough people to manage the door? Who's going to pass out the bulletins? We're just surviving from Sunday to Sunday, and that's a place we had to be. We had to figure out in last year, can we really make it? Can we really just figure out this rhythm, do this, and then have five things we're going to do well all at the same time under the umbrella of prayer and covered in all? Can we do all that? Well, I'm happy to say in 2015, we did figure out that we can. Not only can we, but we're continuing to go on a trajectory going this way. And as we continue to go up and up and up, we have to be prepared to set out the empty chair and be ready that the next time someone's coming to fill that chair, we have the capacity to invite them onto our team, invite them into our grow group. So we've got to learn to live in a portable church in a way, but I've got to move the setup and teardown team to a wider, I've got to go one time per month. Right now we're doing every other week, which is fine, but I need to make room for 25 new servers. When we come into the Easter season and we experience an attendance increase, we're going to have an opportunity where we can invite new people onto our playing field. So I've got to move those people wide and not so deep. I need to have our engagement ratio go down because we have new people coming in at the top. You understand how that works? So it's important. We're always inviting other people in. So in 2016, we have to move past being a come and see church. Well, we have to continue to have come and see things. Come and see what community looks like if you don't know. Come and see what a grow group feels like. Come and see what worship is like in the community of faith. Come and see what generational ministry looks like that's relevant. So you have to have come and see. But in 2016, our focus is going to change to be a go and tell church. Our campus needs to go out and tell about the good news of God and where our story is intersecting with Christ. We need to be a go and tell church out in the baseball field, in the PTO, in the rooms with room moms and room dads at school, on the soccer fields and the baseball fields and the dance competitions and all those other places, your break room at work. We need to be a go and tell church. And sure, we want folks to connect with Faithbridge, but more importantly, we want folks to connect with the love and grace of Jesus Christ. And when they hear your story and you go and tell, that's the intersection of life we want them to have. We want them to connect with all those things so we can go out and be the church. So I ask everyone to pull out your bulletin, and in your bulletin this week we've got this little card that has an empty chair, much like I've drawn right here. It's just an empty card, looks like this, with the empty chair, and I'm just going to ask God to put on your heart names of folks that you think would be needing an intersection with God. How could this person be prayed for? How could I go and tell them about the good news of Jesus Christ? How could I share with them my testimony and the things that God has done in my life and the lives of those around me in my community so that we can be part of that? Well, I'll tell you that we hear all the tension right now in election season, all the rhetoric going on between the political debates. We hear North Korea is launching a missile and flies over, and the panic is all over the news, and everyone's crying, the sky is falling, and everyone's stressed out about all these things. Well, some people are definitely heading toward a hopeless end because they don't have the gospel. As Pastor Ken always says, though, we're ending our lives, or we'll be heading toward endless hope because we have Jesus Christ. We know God is in control in the middle of all these crazy circumstances. And so we want to bring that to others so we can invite them to come into our story so they can come and see the goodness of God. Well, I have told you our story to make sure you can connect with it and intersect with it even now. I've told you what we're doing and how we're doing it, our little rhythm of five things plus prayer. I've told you how it's going, and I've also told you where we're headed this year. Not just to be a come-and-see church, but to be a go-and-tell church as well. And I've told you about a problem we have, that we have an engagement rate that's a little bit too high. We need to make it wide and have room for new people to come into community and serving and growing. And there's going to be some practical ways for us this year as we go and become a go-and-tell church. I'll give you a few to close. The first one, on Saturday, March 5th, we're going to go and fill Easter eggs full with an invitation to Easter services and then also to Vacation Bible School. We're going to go and deliver those door to door as a church. Go out door to door and deliver those Easter eggs and invite them in a cute, unique way. Our kids ministry leader, Kelly, had this idea, and it's going to be fantastic. So bring your family, bring your friends, read about it in your bulletin. We're going to deliver those to 2,000 homes around us. Also, if you're not in a grow group yet, I need you to come out to the Connection Center, write on your connection card, let Leah connect you and help you connect into a grow group so you can experience community. Also, we need about 25 of you to jump in and widen our team on the setup and teardown team so we can have spots for about 25 new folks who will be coming. As you leave today, our greeters will be giving you random acts of kindness cards. Go out and buy someone's coffee. Bless someone with lunch. In a practical way, just go out and let's bless this community so they know that Faith Bridges are out there fulfilling what God calls us to do and be blessings to others. I want you to take your open chair, your empty chair card with you with the names on it. Be praying over those. For the next 3 or 4 weeks, every week, we're going to be praying for those here at Faith Bridge, even from the front, lifting up who God might bring to us. And then I want you to, as Pastor Ken announced today, I'm very excited about Vacation Bible School. That's going to be a way to go and tell 440-some kids we'll be able to invite into our story and be on our Woodlands campus on June 13th. Mark your calendar for that. It's a great way for us to do that. So as your campus pastor, let me just say, I know the best times are straight ahead as God continues to intersect so many lives in our story along the way every week at the Woodlands campus, at the Klein campus, as we're bridges of faith every day where we're living. So I'm just going to challenge us this year to be a go-and-tell church. And as your campus pastor, more importantly, at this moment, I just want to celebrate what God has done over the last 12 months and wish you, Woodlands Campus of Faith Bridge, a very happy birthday. Why don't we pray together? Lord, thanks for our time. Thank you for this year of learning. Thank you that we are able to get together as a community of faith to be going and telling about your goodness. God, so that people will come and see what the community of faith looks like at your local church. Help Faith Bridge just be one. It's a light on a hill, Lord, that others are drawn to it. Lord, right now for those who are in our community around us, at the Woodlands campus, at the Klein campus, even internationally, Lord, who listen to us and join us online, Lord, won't you just move in their hearts right now? By your Spirit, bring them the comfort that they need. Lord, bring them the instruction and the word that you have for them. Lord, I pray for transformed lives. Lord, help us help others connect into your story. That's what the local church is for, is to intersect with God. Lord, thank you for bringing us into your story, just like the Israelites all the way back in the Old Testament. I know you have a plan for us, and your plan is redemption and forgiveness through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we love you and we trust you. In Jesus' name, amen.